front, you can kind of see what's coming up for the month of June. So take a look and check it out. Slack key guitar is starting up and a couple other fun classes. And if you want to be on the mailing list for the Cultural Center, I'll put a sheet up there. And again, thank you to the people that provided food. Thank you, Shannon, for being here. Oh, and if you haven't signed up on our Farmers Union sign-in sheet, just go ahead and sign in. You don't have to be a member if you're not a member yet. I put a little thing there, you can say yes or no, and if you want to be one, I'll follow up with you, and we can make that happen. There's lots of cool benefits and different perks that you can get. Yeah, the Farmers Union is like just getting started. We've only been in Hawaii for about 2 years, been in the state for about 6. So it's a really exciting time for us to just be developing the organization as something to serve the community and to really be useful for our farmers and gardeners and anyone who's just interested in eating good food and having good agriculture on the island. So I know all you guys are in alignment with that. And the more we can come together and have our voices heard collectively, the better it is in terms of legislation and bills and getting our voices to the people that are really making the decisions up there. Last month we had a really great meeting down in Hilo that was like a candidate forum. So we had candidates all from our chapter here come down and just kind of like, we talked story, we had questions, it was really great, and we're hoping to do another one of those next month. So that'll be in June, I can't remember the day right now, the third Tuesday in June. But it's in the works right now, it'll either be in Hilo or it might be in Pahoa so that we can serve our constituents down there, because our East chapter is unfortunately really large. it goes all the way from Pahoa up here to Honokaa, and then Kohala has another chapter for them. So yeah, exciting things happening. Stay in touch with us, sign up on the mailing list. And without further ado, I will introduce our guest speakers tonight. We have Shannon Schultz.
I was at that forum and I recorded it.
And yeah.
It's on YouTube at Occupy Hawaii.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, a little search, you'll be able to find it.
I should blast that out to people.
Yeah.
Cool. Right on, yeah.
I think I put it on your Facebook page too, on the
really?
Farmers Market.
Oh, really
Farmers Union page.
Okay. Here we are. We're going to have a little talk about the economics of on farm pollination. It'll be talk with our lovely Shannon Schultz, our local beekeeper here. She's got Being Aloha, an amazing
tree
company that provides all kinds of local products made from the bees. She takes every part of the process and turns it into something that you can enjoy. So salves and bee pollen, all kinds of stuff, lip stuff and SPF stuff. So check her out. She's at Saturday Market at Parker, Sunday Market at right here in Honokaa.
College level classes, and I love every one of the age groups for various reasons. I tend to favor small kids because they wear the outfits that I make them and they do what I tell them to do. So, to be asked to talk about the economics of beekeeping is like, oh, something new for my brain. I'm not on autopilot, so I had to go back and check my statistics. So, we're not going to cover a lot of the basics. You guys are pretty much all farmers. You know pretty much that you're going to need pollination. So we'll skip that stuff. I brought in a lot of beekeeping stuff. So what we're interested in is, as a farmer, do you need pollinators? And why do you need pollinators? How much is it going to really cost to get pollinators there? Do you want to do it, or do you want to hire a beekeeper to do it? So I'll have to say that in the state of Hawaii, we're really the only state that that's not familiar with paying for pollination. We have had ample pollination here for hundreds of years, and we don't have the kind of monoculture that you'll see on the mainland where you have 5,000 acres of one crop, and either that's blooming, and when it's not blooming, it's just dead. So those are the kind of crops that people tend to need to bring in bees for the almonds and for the blueberries and stuff like that. So in the state of Hawaii, we've had a ban on bringing bees into the state for the last 100 years because we had an outbreak of diseases 100 years ago that wiped out our bees. So the honeybees are not native to Hawaii. We do have a native bee here that's a solitary bee. It's a green-faced bee. You can find it Keanu and up. They're all native pollinators. Before that, we had the birds. We don't really have the birds anymore that we used to have. And our agriculture has evolved to which we need pollinators. The mac nuts, the avocados, these are things that are not native to Hawaii. Now we have them and we have to have pollinators. So a little bit of a history of how we got pollinators here. Our bees are intricately bound with Parker Ranch. Does anybody know that story? So when King Kalakaua decided that they were gonna start maintaining the cattle that was the gift, you know, they're not just gonna let them run in the fields. They brought over the Paniolos, the Portuguese, the Mexicans to like teach the people here how to maintain the cattle. And so the cattle needed to have some kind of food, which at that time they fed them kiabi beans. So they brought the kiabi here to feed the cattle. The kiabi had to have pollinators. Beekeeping started in Hawaii in Waimea. A lot of people are like, can I have bees in Waimea? Will they live there? That was the beginning of all the islands. We had tried to get pollinators here through the mid-1800s. And that was before the Panama Canal was built. They were trying to bring bees from the East Coast, like around South America. The sailors, you know, they're not tending to the bees. They get here, they're dead. And so in the 1850s, the king said, I'll give $100 to somebody that can get a hive here, per hive. It was a lot of money. So there was a scramble. I'm not exactly sure where those bees came from in the world, but they got here. That was the beginning. So as a farmer, you're going to have to decide, do you even need pollinators? So there's a lot of crops that don't need pollinators. Pineapples, taro, if you're doing more native foods, you're not going to need pollinators. But if you're doing other things, you are going to need pollinators. So I brought a couple different hive structures here. So there's a lot of talk with people of like, what hive is the best hive? Oh, my hives are this or my hives are that. So let me do a little bit of a disclaimer. Every beekeeper, just like every farmer, has a different way of doing things. And, you know, I am 100% behind what I believe at this moment. Next week, if I learn something new, I will abandon what I said here and move on. And I hope that everybody does that in their practice. So, you know, if there's something that I say that is bullshit, prove it, and I will evolve from there. So, I have several different hive types on my apiaries. I started doing beekeeping in Asia with a stingless variety of bees as a teenager and never thought I would do beekeeping. And I am a performance art major and was the high school sex ed teacher here in town, so obviously that transferred to becoming a beekeeper. Our bees were in trouble, and I just felt like, what am I gonna do about it? You know, I have a child, I wanna see him, see me doing a community project. If it's not bees, it would be something else. But for me, I felt really drawn to bees. So most of my hives are the Langstroth hives. These are square hives, everybody's really familiar with them. They're stacked up. Generally, the queen lays at the bottom, you have brood at the bottom, and every subsequent box is generally honey on the top. These hives came about, and some people think that they're the downfall of bees. They certainly can have their negative effects, but they can also have their positive effects. One of the reasons that I use these instead of some other hive designs that we'll cover is because they're all uniform sizes. And I transfer from one hive to another, I'll borrow things. And when I make hives, nothing is uniform. I can't get them from one box to another. So I like these. This is not a working hive, but it gives you an idea. So you generally have 10 frames on the top. A lot of beekeepers use foundation. I no longer use foundation. We'll get into that later. I also have top bar hives. So top bar hives are also called like Kenyan migratory hives. And I didn't bring one in because they're all in use. And so basically with the top bar hive, the idea is that you can build it out of whatever material you have, and then maybe you can break it down, move it, and build it again. They are generally a triangle shape with a flat bottom, and the bees, instead of going onto a full frame like this, the bees build their comb off of this. And you could have a long box, and you could have numerous numerous bars in there. There are pros and cons to this. For me, there are pros and cons for this one. I like using them both for different reasons. So if you are deciding that you need to start hives on your property, you really have to figure out what you want to pollinate, and you have to get an idea of how many bees you need. So it's generally 1 to 3 hives per acre, depending on what you're pollinating. And, you know, go more if, you know, go 3 and err on the side of caution. So to start a hive like this, just to get the equipment, if you're not going to build it yourself, you're going to order it and you're going to have it shipped here, it's going to cost you about $250 to $300 depending on shipping. Yes, Gary.
For a newt, or is that for
this is just hive? For the hive. We're not even talking the bees. We're talking the wood.
Oh.
Yes. And so I like, there's a lot of beekeeping companies. The Dant, D-A-N-A-T, builds great equipment. Their shipping is exorbitant. I originally thought I was only going to have 3 hives when I started this company, but I went ahead and got 5 hives just to be on the side of caution, and it went from like a hobby to an obsession in like 5 seconds. And now I'm at 50 hives, and it's taken over my life. So, you know, in that case, if you're going to order a lot, you'll get them shipped over and get them at the yard. Amazon.com on Prime is a great thing. If you don't have Prime, you get free shipping. They don't have all the equipment that you need. A lot of times you can get equipment left over from beekeepers that have failed, and then you'll have to take the risk of, do you want to take on their possible fungus in that equipment, or do you want to start fresh?
Yeah.
So if you were to go this route with this box, you're looking at about $350, maybe a little bit less, but around there. And that does not include the bees. So there are a few beekeepers on the island that sell bees. Sometimes I sell bees, usually I don't. And I'm like, I really want to make sure that you are going to take care of them. So I'm kind of annoying like that to get bees from. And I'm more than happy to help people get started, but I very rarely sell bees. But if I am not selling bees, then I know for sure who is selling bees. And I would only point people to beekeepers that I know, and I stand behind their practices. So if you get a hive like this, you're going to need to get a nuke. And a nuke is basically a 5 to 7 frame box of bees. They don't give you the box anymore. They used to give you like a cardboard box of the bees, and now they're like, that box is $30. You bring your own box,
yeah,
and I'll put $150 worth of bees in there. And so, you know, you're getting upwards of $500 for one hive. And, you know, you have 10, 15, 20, 30 acres. Is that going to do it for you? And then if you go with these square hives, you're also buying into the idea that you're going to use an extractor. And these use centrifugal force to spin the honey out. Extractors are exorbitant. You're looking anywhere from like, I mean, you could get a two-frame bucket spinner that a lot of people start with, and they're like, I don't mind manual labor. I'll just spin two things at a time. And like a week later, you're like, oh man, I need to go up to a four-frame. And you know, they can go all the way up to $30,000. Generally, beekeepers don't share their extractors because I don't want your funk in my equipment. So people are always like, can we have a community extractor and kind of hooey it up? And you know, unless I know you're clean, then no, you can't get in my equipment. So with this, you know, you've already invested over $1,000 and you just have one hive.
And now you're gonna place to put them.
Now you need a place to put them. So that's assuming that you have property. In the last 10 years, we've had three different pests that have hit Hawaii. We've had the small hive beetle, which looks like a ladybug, but it's all black. We've had varroa mite, which looks like a tick. And we've had Nosema serrana, which is a gut virus. It gives the bees diarrhea. They don't live as long, and they don't feel like working because they have diarrhea. So all three of those pests hit our hives at the same time. They had been on the mainland for 25, 30 years. The hive beetle and the varroa mite have come up from Africa. But on the mainland, the bees had had like 10, 15 years between each catastrophe to kind of like get over the hump. So here they basically hit the same time, and we lost 80% of our hives in the state. They just crashed. And so even though, you know, we knew it was coming, you don't know a catastrophe until it hits. And so it's like most of the beekeepers had read up, okay, I'm gonna do this and I'm gonna do that. And then you get here and your bees are dying and you feel like a failure. And a lot of beekeepers aren't even talking about it. They're just like, my bees are fine. And you're like, well, maybe I'm just the lame one with the dead bees. And so it was really difficult for beekeepers to decide what we're gonna do about this issue. Myself, there's a handful of other beekeepers that are all organic. And that there are the people that are saying, don't do anything to treat these problems because your bees can't evolve if you step in. I get that on some level. But on the other level, I think, well, if they're all dead, you know, what have we proven? And so, you know, every beekeeper had to decide, what are you comfortable with? You know, when do you step in and when do you step back? And, you know, beekeeping has been a major life lesson for me for every aspect of my life. You know, when do you step in? What are you comfortable with doing? How can you make a positive change? And when do you just step back and let things play out? So I don't need to necessarily get into my, I'll get a little bit into it. And then I also want to hear where people's interest lies, because I can talk about bees in every direction, I assure you. So I really wanted to be organic. I felt like I needed to do something. I started out with formic acid to treat the varroa because that is in the organic realm. It's really hard on the bees. It would burn their eyes. It would burn their skin. It was hard to breathe. A lot of times they left. So it was like a 50-50 chance. Are you gonna help them or are you gonna kill them? And you're like, well, they're dying anyway, so. And myself and another few beekeepers learned how to test for hygienic traits. I'll go briefly into that. I don't need to get, if you wanna ask me about it more. And so hygienic traits are a trait that bees naturally have, but we haven't needed them because we didn't have a lot of pests. So we haven't been looking for that trait when we breed bees because we didn't need it. Now all of a sudden we need it and we're like, quick, let's get those traits back up. But you know, there's a process, and it's taken me like 6 years to be completely, you know, my bees are taking care of themselves, and still there's some manipulations that I do. And so basically what we were doing to test for hygienic traits is going into the brood chamber, that's capped brood, putting a little paint chip, and killing in a triangle. You know, I guess that would turn in because they're in a diagonal, I don't know, 8, 12 cells, piercing them, putting them back into the hive. And then seeing, can you recognize that that's non-viable? Clean it out, buff it up, and get it ready for the queen to lay it again in 18 hours. And if they could do it in 18 hours, I would take them down to 10 hours. And then I would take it down to 4 hours. Can you 100% of the time recognize that this is non-viable, clean it up, get it going? And so I had to make a really hard decision to only take care of the bees that could do that, because all the other ones were sucking my time and I was nursing. It was a hospice situation in my house. and I felt terrible. And if you ever see me like in town and I'm in a bad mood, it's because nothing brings me down like bees being sick. I really am devastated. So, you know, I bred from those bees, so showing those hygienic traits translates to them being able to take care of the pests themselves. Now, people have sunk millions of dollars into investigating this, and people have done these similar techniques in labs. But, you know, I'm nobody in Honokaa with, like, no equipment and not very good note-taking skills, and even I could do it. So, I know, everybody can do it. So let's talk about this, the top bar hive. So one of the, there's many things that are good about this. I am not a good carpenter, but I can make this in like under an hour and a half for under $20. Has anybody seen top bar hives? They're triangular and they're like a long trough, and these just fit in on top. And basically you put the bees in the box and you let them draw out the comb, because that's what they do. We don't really need to step in. You generally, I cut this on a table saw that has a slant on the blade, and you cut it at an angle, and that's what indicates to the bees when all these are lined up that that's where they're gonna build their comb. There's lots of ideas for this online. A lot of people just do a square piece of wood and then they cut a trough and then they glue popsicle sticks in, and I'm just like, no. But I also think that the fewer cracks that you have in your hive, the better.
Yep.
And so one of the benefits of this is that if you can't lift a 100-pound box of honey for any reason, you could do a top bar hive and you're just lifting one frame at a time. Another benefit is that when this is full of honey, you could just cut this off, put it in a bucket. You don't need an extractor. You can just crush it, have 2 5-gallon buckets, have a paint strainer on the top, and let it drip down. Easy peasy like that. Under $20. If you catch wild bees, don't take them out of a tree where they're situated, but if somebody has a swarm, if you catch wild bees, you could be in the bee business for under, I don't know, $80, saying you get some bee equipment. You know, so people are like, why doesn't everybody have this kind of hive? Well, if you're gonna have, you know, 4 or 5 or 10 or even 25 of these, it's manageable. If you have a farm and you're doing other stuff, you can't have 20, 50 buckets of honey draining with ants and roaches in the rain and all that. So I have some top bar hives, I like them. When I extract, I generally like to get it done in one day. I'll take the boxes off, get them extracted, get the boxes back on the hive that same day. Because without the bees attending to the boxes, pests will get them. The small hive beetles will find them. And so I like to get that process done. Honey is also called, it is hygroscopic. Does anybody know that word? So it's just like salt, it is constantly absorbing moisture from the environment. When the bees bring the nectar back, and they mix it with the enzymes in their mouth and they put it in the cell, that's not honey. They have to dehydrate that down 90% to take the moisture out before they cap it over, then it's honey. Once it's dehydrated, it'll never go bad. But if you have honey that's just out and exposed, it's always going to be absorbing moisture, and then it's going to ferment. And that's not necessarily bad, but it might not be what you want. So if you just need a few hives, there are a lot of examples of how to do a top bar hive online. Like I said, they're relatively inexpensive. But because of our pest, you're going to have some sort of screening at the bottom. So for my square hives, every hive has a screened bottom board. And so this one, originally I started getting them from Dedance. They're basically like $25. Then by the time they get here, they're like $78. And they have a fancy tray that goes underneath, but they were pretty flimsy. So I have a friend building these on island for me. I made it so it could carry a plastic lunch tray like you would see at a fast food place. And the most expensive thing about the hive is the construction cloth at the bottom. This is 1/8 construction cloth. It's not an easy diameter to get for some reason. Garden Exchange has it. It's like $3.50 a foot. If you're just doing five hives or so, that's not a lot. If you're doing a lot, you might want to get a roll. Sometimes Ikiuchi sells it, but other than that, it's really hard to get. So all of my hives have this on it at all the times. In the tray, I either use vegetable oil or I use diatomaceous earth. And both of those will work in getting the pests. So the bees chase the small hive beetles down. The diatomaceous earth cuts up their exoskeletons. They die. You can feed the diatomaceous earth with the small hive beetles in it to your chickens, and then you can reuse the diatomaceous earth. I find certain hives locations I can do that, but if you're in a high moisture area, it kind of crusts over on the top, and then the hive beetles are just like walking on the top, and that is always a hassle. So as much as I hate using oil, because you have to have everything level, and then it like adds this whole nother dynamic of filth to your work when you're covered in oil. But that's what I primarily use, because even when it's funky, it'll drown the hive beetles. And it'll also drown the varroa mites. So Zoe had mentioned some of the products that I sell. So part of my obsession is mostly making sure that I take care of bees in a healthy manner. You know, we all hear about sustainability. Oh, we want to be sustainable. So what that means to me as a beekeeper is that I am sustainable, that I'm not letting my bees die and then buying more from somewhere else. So, you know, as much as a lot of people want to start beekeeping, there are all these clues that you need to learn in order to be successful and in order to be sustainable. And a lot of people keep their hives for about 18 months to 2 years, and then they just kind of collapse, and they don't really know why. And so there are, I would advise anybody that wanted to start beekeeping to work with a beekeeper. Because even if you don't like what they're doing, you'll learn something. You learn what you want to do in the hive, you'll learn what you don't want to do in the hive, but you'll always learn something. But I think of it as like a murder mystery. There's all these little things that come together, and you have to kind of put a synopsis together. So even before I've opened the hive, I'm looking what is going on inside and out. Are they bringing in pollen? Yes, there's something. They're getting food. Are they bringing in a diverse color of pollen? Awesome. Are there bees like rolling around on the ground outside the hive? What's the issue? Does the hive smell funky? What's the issue? If something smells funky, it's funky. And you need to figure out what the issue is. It could be that your oil's rank. It could be that the bees are sick. But that's an issue that you have to put together. And so all of this is before you even open the hive. And then once you open the hive, the bees have personalities. Not just because of their genetics, because they do things at certain times. And they also sound different at different times. Just like people, when they're pissed, they get louder. And they get like more erratic. And you open a hive and you see like a lot of this. And sometimes you're like, I don't know what is going on there, but I'll give you a little minute and I'll come back to you, you know? And that's something that you need to figure out. Is it because it's cloudy outside? Is it, you know, is it because they've been inside because of the rain? Is it because there's no queen? You don't know, but you need to figure out what's going on. Now, everybody asks me, like, do you get stung? And I'm like, no shit, I get stung. Every time I get stung, though, it's my fault. And I'm not just a martyr, but, you know, the more I'm stressed, the more erratic I am, the more likely it is that my bees are going to sting me. And it's generally the end of the day when I'm tired and I thought I was done, but guess what, I have another 2 hours of work to do, and then I end up getting stung. Now, there are a lot of bees that are more docile. I have some bees that I don't need any protection with, and some bees hear my truck coming, and they're already out to get me. And so we'll take it to the hive suit. Some people don't like to wear a hive suit. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. When I was 40, I invested in a ventilated hive suit. They're more expensive, but it's a real issue to get overheated in the hive here. So Man Lake is a good place to get ventilated hive suits from. It basically is like a three-layer suit, and the stings won't go through, but you can be in your bathing suit, which is kind of unnerving. You open a hive, and you hear all these bees around, and you feel a breeze, and you think, shit, is my fly down? Like, where am I exposed? But they're really good for, like, keeping you from overheating. They're going to be anywhere from, like, $90 to $150 for that suit.
You totally recommend the ventilated hive suit, because I've been putting that off for a long time.
I didn't do it because I was like, I don't need it, it's too expensive. It used to be only one company that sold it, and they were like $200.
Right.
That's when I was 40, I was like, I'm splashing out. And now Man Lake sells them. And you can get like the half the ventilated.
Right.
They're really bulky. And so like, you're gonna be a big old bear in that suit, and that takes a lot to get used to. I say it's totally worth it because I do a lot of hive removals where I'm alone and I'm up 25 feet and I thought it was gonna be 4 hours, now it's like 8 hours in and I'm hot and I'm tired and nobody's there and I could easily like fall off the roof. So really, these suits have really helped me out. So there's many products that come out of the hive, not just honey. We talked about how on the mainland, there people use pollination. So also on the mainland, honey production is less than 10% of a beekeeper's income. Most of their income comes from pollination. So all the people that are paying for pollination are paying like $175 to $215 per hive for 3 weeks of pollination. So people are taking their bees to the almonds, taking their bees to the canola, trucking them around, and their honey is kind of a byproduct that they don't even want to deal with. So then they usually sell it to the big box stores, and the box stores bottle it and sell it. You know, they buy it in bulk, and then that way they can just focus on the pollination. For years, I had a really negative attitude about those guys that ship their bees, and you know, and they're the issues with the bees dying, until like I met beekeepers from Oregon that said, you know, or Vermont that was like, well, our bees are in the snow 6 months out of the year, so they would be happier in Florida for the oranges than they would be in the snow. And then I was like, all right, well, maybe, but you still kind of suck. So I definitely like have my own bias on some things like that. So let's see some other income. So there are other hive designs besides this. There are a plethora of hive designs, and there are lots of people who say like this hive design is saving the bees and that one is killing the bees.
Oh, God.
So, you know, there's people that are like, well, they have to be in a hexagon. on, and they have to be like a sacred geometry, and they have to be like this and that. I follow the belief that all of my bees have a view. I only put my bees in a place of beauty, because generally a place of beauty, they're happier, there's gonna be better pollination. That's just me. Plus I like to see Honokaa in the ocean when I'm in my bees. So I always make sure that my bees are in a place of beauty. So, but there are other hive designs. The main thing that I have changed in my practice, it's one of the things, is that when I started off, everybody used foundation. And these are plastic, I don't use plastic, but most people would buy foundation, wax, beeswax foundation, and it gives the bees like an indicator, this is what you want to build off of. 100% of the foundation coming from the mainland is contaminated with pesticides, 100%. Every bee that has come in contact with something, they bring it back to the hive, and the beeswax absorbs that. And so you can process it, you can heat it, you can roll it out into new sheets. Essentially, you're giving your bees something that's already gonna make them sick. There are some people, Richard Spiegel started making his own foundation. The equipment, if you wanted to make the foundation, which is basically like an industrial pasta roller that imprints it, you're looking at like $4,000 for that equipment. It's almost unattainable.
So, Shannon, you feel like then the process in making the foundation is impregnating chemicals in there?
No. I am saying that the beeswax that you're getting from somewhere, those bees have gone out into the field, been exposed to different things, they bring it back, it's automatically. It's not the processing of the beeswax, it's that those bees produce that beeswax, they live on that beeswax, they store their food in that beeswax, they're leaving footprints on that beeswax, so anything they've come in contact with is gonna be in that beeswax.
Okay, but I'm still not clear. The foundation itself, if you're ordering foundation for your frame, do you have an issue with that, or do you have an issue with foundation that's coming
it's
in?
It's recycled wax.
It's recycled wax.
And the bees don't wipe their feet or take their shoes off.
So the foundation itself is made from recycled wax.
Yes, yes. We're using beeswax, so it's not man-made. It's coming from the bees. I still have some wax foundations in my hive, and it's not something that I've just like overnight like gotten rid of. It's something that I have evolved out of. So basically, when you go foundationless, when you're in a hive like this, is that you would give the bees this, and they'll build it. So you might not get as much honey, because it takes a bee eating 8 pounds of honey to make 1 pound of wax. But they can do that, and it's gonna be fresh. And if you have them in a clean environment, your wax is gonna be clean, so ultimately your bees are theoretically gonna be healthier. I oftentimes go ahead and still wire them. We used to wire them because this held the wax foundation. You would kind of weave it in and print it. But now, I especially wire my bottom box, because when I use centrifugal force to extract this, it gives it a little bit of strength. Does anybody have any more questions on the wax?
Yeah, so what do you recommend instead of using that as like a foundation so you don't use plastic?
I recommend letting your bees do what they do. I recommend maybe starting with wax and transitioning out. A lot of times when you get a nuke, you're gonna have somebody give you foundation. That's a start. Maybe you can see it as like a goal to transition out of that. There's a lot of organic beekeepers that are totally fine even using this plastic and covering that with wax. If you just put these plastic foundations in, the bees don't like them, and they kind of like try to make their comb in between when they're like together, and then you'll see like some in-between thing because the bees are like, I'm not touching that. But if you cover them with beeswax, they will draw this out. You know, you would melt the beeswax and pour it on. Then when you use centrifugal force, this is gonna not give. And people like that when they're in big productions. I get that, I totally get that. I'm trying not to use that though. That's the stage where I'm at. Yes?
So I took the plunge and got a extractor, a little three-frame extractor, because it would take them so long to refilled the cone, and I was just crushing it. You know, I was just squeezing it by hand, like you said. And I'm able to get way more honey because I use an extractor, and then they can just fill it up again, as opposed to building it all, and the honey's still coming in, there's nowhere to put it.
Right. So you just take out some out of a hive?
Everything that I take out, I put through the extractor, unless it's Hamakua, and then I squeeze it by hand.
So as farmers, if you want to have pollinators, another agenda that I have that I'm not going to hide is that our beekeepers on the island are struggling. We've been struggling, you know, a lot of the old beekeepers totally gave it up because it was like, for one, a lot of people that had been beekeeping for years, they couldn't transition past the die-off. They didn't have it in them. A lot of beekeepers are retired men anyway, and so a lot of the new beekeepers are like super passionate but maybe not have years of experience. When I started, I found out that I was really good at grafting queens, and so I offered that service to every senior beekeeper on island. Wow. And so I would go to their property, I would make their queens, and I would suck their information from them. And you know, we should all be learning techniques from the elders. And not all of their techniques I liked, but a lot of them I did. And it's I got to meet a lot of interesting people. So products out of the hive. Obviously we get honey out of the hive. Zoe was talking about how you make products out of the hive. Beeswax is a huge product. I make candles. You can do a plethora of things. You can get rid of so many toxic things in your house and make them out of beeswax. I polish my boots with them. We polish our cutting boards with them. I use it for lip balm. I make lotions. I make sunblock. I've come out with a underarm deodorant that's made out of the beeswax and local coconut oil from Puna, so my pits don't stink. There's also pollen is one of the things that I collect out of the hive that I sell in two different forms. This is a dry form. The bees also bring it in, and the way that they eat their pollen and honey is they collect the pollen and the honey, they mix it with the enzymes in their mouth, and they put it together and they ferment it. And so the pollen has every vitamin, mineral, omega that our bodies need, and it's 60% protein. Once you ferment it, then that fermentation also breaks down the kernel of the pollen, so it makes it easier to digest that. They call it bee bread when the pollen is in the comb. I maybe pull out 15, 20 jars of that a year, and it goes to like the people in the know. And the people that aren't in the know look at it and they're like, I am not putting that in my mouth. But it's seriously one of the best things that you can get out of the hive. If you want, you know, check with me. Sometimes I have it, oftentimes I don't. This is propolis. So bees make propolis out of plant resin, and they mix it with the enzymes in their mouth. They like to get their spit in there, it's magical. They use propolis to seal up any cracks in the hive, but they also use it to sterilize inside of their hive. It is very high in antimicrobial, antifungal. You see propolis in mouthwash, you see it in toothpaste. It's really good for oral hygiene. Once you make it a liquid, it's really good for those cuts that you might get in the taro patch where you need a Band-Aid, but you know you can never use a Band-Aid because it's just gonna go into the ground. Propolis will seal that shut. It'll make it black, it'll look really ugly, but not only will it help the cut heal, it'll also seal it shut. So I'll pass this around, you guys can smell it if you want to. This propolis comes from the Hamakua coast. The propolis that I get closer to this area tends to be black. I make it a liquid out of honey alcohol, which is another product that comes out of the hive. If I have honey that I've gotten that I can't sell for whatever reason, it's got moisture in it, yada yada, it's been in the solar wax melter, it's not great, good to sell, but I can ferment it, which I like to do. So I make a mead out of it. The mead takes between 12 months and beyond. Once that I have that mead, which is honey wine, I have a small still. Nobody tell anybody? And I take it down to like a 90 proof. The 90 proof is what I soak the propolis in. I shake it for like 6 weeks to a month. That's how I generally sell my propolis. A lot of orchestra players come for it because it's the traditional way to like seal the resin in their instruments that I don't know anything about, but they seek it out. This is $60 a pound. It's, you know, it's, you're not gonna get a lot of it, but it is another value-added product that comes out of the hive. Yes?
Do you ever judiciously make any of your royal jelly?
So a lot of people ask me about royal jelly. Does anybody not know what royal jelly is? So everybody heard of royal jelly? So bees make royal jelly in order to produce a queen. In the larva life of a bee, the first 3 days of their life, every little egg gets a little teeny, teeny bit of royal jelly. And the royal jelly is only produced by bees that are like between 8 and 12 days old. They have a gland in their head where they can produce royal jelly. So once the 3 days has passed, the bees only get honey and pollen. Unless, say, something happens to the queen. There's only one queen in a hive. Something happens to the queen. They have, you know, days to produce a new queen. So they have to take eggs that are 3 days old or less. And instead of feeding them instead of feeding them honey and pollen, they'll feed them 1,400 times a day royal jelly. and then that is over here. So that egg now, instead of being capped and flat, will come out like a peanut shape because the queens are big and they're packed in over royal jelly. So that egg, it can only be a female egg, which is another interesting thing. The queens have the option of laying non-fertilized eggs that will become male bees or fertilized eggs that will become females with non-working ovaries. So they'll take one of those females with non-working ovaries, crank her diet with 100% royal jelly, and recreate another queen. So he was asking me, do I ever eat royal jelly?
I'm judiciously removing royal jelly.
That's not to say that I don't get it. So I collect it. I generally keep a little disc in my pocket for royal jelly collection because when I was grafting queens for people, I would have a little bit more success if I gave them each a little bit more royal jelly. Without the royal jelly, I was having about an 86% acceptance rate. With a little bit of royal jelly and a little bit of water, I was like 96-98%. You know, when I'm grafting for other people, I'll graft 50 to 100 bees. If I'm grafting for myself, I'll graft 5 because I'm not that big. And so he was asking, do I use the royal jelly? If I don't have that little container in my pocket, which is often, I will eat the royal jelly. I don't get enough royal jelly to sell. Tons of people ask me if I sell royal jelly. So there are a couple places on the mainland that are producing royal jelly, so I won't say it all comes from China, but pretty much it all comes from China. And it's huge. I don't know how much it is an ounce, but it is way more than gold.
Don't buy royal jelly.
And so what happens for these people to get royal jelly is they're constantly putting their hive in a state of stress, where they don't feel like they're having a queen, and they're like, oh my god, we have to make a queen. Let's feed all these bees royal jelly and make queens. And then they're going in, they have a little vacuum, kind of like a dentist sucking thing, and they're sucking it up. And so when you see royal jelly for sale, know that thousands and thousands of bees have been riddled with anxiety for you to get that. Now, as a beekeeper, I get it, but I usually don't sell it. In fact, I've never sold it. It tastes funky. I don't even know, like, what the flavor tastes with. Pungent, maybe? It's, like, creamy, and it's white, and it's, like... But it's really good for you, so you eat it. Anyway, yes, Yuri.
I recently heard from a friend that they've done studies testing for what the mucus like gold kills and roll like out easiest, and it's temperature. A little bit of temperature difference that they can't stand that the bees can stand. But I was wondering if you heard anything about the beetles. I've got my oil tray, I tried to dust your shirt, like you said, it doesn't work, too humid. They drop honey and pollen in there. I saw these little metal strips online, I wanted to get them, but then I thought, oh, it's, like you said, it's expensive, I'll just make it myself, really. Wondering if you had any tips for that.
For controlling the hive beetles beyond
the
trays.
I have the oil trap, I have the individual little traps in there.
So there are shop rags. That is like all the rage for the beetles. I have some waiting for me at the Department of Agriculture. I haven't picked it up. It's not just any blue shop rag. It's a certain kind of shop rag. And people are successfully putting it on the top of their bees, and the beetles are getting trapped in there, but the bees are not getting trapped in there. I've been dragging my feet on getting into the Department of Agriculture to try it out.
What is it?
Pardon?
What is it?
It's like a dryer sheet slash
so
shop
rag. So their feet get
rag.
Stuck on it like Velcro.
Yes,
or something.
But if you don't get the right ones, the bees will chew it up and you'll see it all in the front of your hive.
Right.
So I will get further information on that. I think it's a great idea, even in conjunction with the oil tray. But saying that, we didn't have bad hive beetles on this coast for years. I would have my bees in Pune, or I would help beekeepers down there, and they'd open their hives and there'd be like 50,
oh.
And I'd be like, you got funky hives down here. And, you know, but in my hive, I would have like 3, and I'd be like, oh, you have to die. And,
yeah.
You know, in the last year, I had so many beetles that I, on my personal property, I stopped keeping bees there for 6 months because I wanted them to get out of the soil. Now I have the bees back. I'm happy that the bees are back, but it didn't seem to make that much of a difference.
I could just stand there for an hour and smash them.
One of the things is to make sure that your hives are up and ventilated off the ground. Where else are we going to take this conversation? Any more questions? Yes.
How are you doing with wax moth?
Wax moth is not an issue. When wax moth, for me, when wax moth first hit Hawaii, everybody was like, oh my god, our bees are gonna die, wax moth. And now it's like, we have real gangsters in the hives, and the wax moths are like, nothing. So,
Shannon, again, with your practice, the bees are staying on top of the bees.
If the times that, so wax moth is a moth that lives in the hive, it eats the wax, it'll eat the larva. You'll see it in the hive. If you have wax moths in your hive, it's because you have other issues. And it's the same way with if you have an extensive amount of hive beetles in the hive, people are like, hive beetles killed my hive. And I'm like, no, it really didn't. It's usually because you have high Varroa mite count, your queen isn't laying enough. There are other issues. When I talk back of like a murder mystery novel, there are other issues. So a lot of times you can look in your hive and you can have tons of honey and you think, yay, I'm a success story. That can be a bad sign. Because why do you have so much honey? Is the queen not laying? Do you not have a queen? Like, do you have honey mixed with your brood? I saw a picture of a friend's beehive on the mainland. He's like, yay, my hives are successful. And I looked at that picture and I was like, no. But then, like, you know, how much do people want me to stick my nose in their hive? So we'll see if they're interested. But when you look at a beehive, you want to see, let's see if I have any. So this is a natural comb here. You know, like I said, they raise their young on here, but when a queen is laying, you want all of the same age of larvae in one area. If you have some here, some there, if you have pollen mixed in, and if you have honey dispersed in between your brood, you got an issue. And the issue is that your queen is not good. And I am really guilty on giving the queen a second chance because maybe she's having a bad day. You know, like, I'm willing to work with her. And that was one of my biggest downfalls of a beekeeper is being, like, not on top of it. I don't want to kill a bee. I can't even do it. replace her.
Is there some way to send them to just let them
a retirement go? Home? You can tell yourself that, but you're not. I mean, you're not. So still to this day, I've never squished a queen. I just, I can't do it. But I'll make a split. So that's another way that your hives can be healthy. If you want a healthy hive, you have got to split that hive at least twice a year. Do not think that you can get a hive and just be like, I love bees, I'm gonna let them be in there, it's gonna be totally righteous. For the health of the bees, you have to split. And the reason that you split is that you make a break in the brood cycle. So the queen's not laying, they're making a new queen. Those varroa mite are only gestating in the male drone brood because they gestate for 16 days, so the varroa can crawl in there, they get a mate in there, a little hoochie-coochie in the cell, they can have babies and then crawl into the next hatching of the drone brood. So if you make a break in your brood cycle, that is going to be a natural way to take down your varroa mite. So when you're looking at your hive and you're thinking, this hive is healthy, I'm the shit, that's the time that you should be splitting. And whether or not you have them make their own queen, or you decide to order a queen from somebody, that's up to you. But that break in the brood cycle is going to naturally drop your mite levels, and it's going to give you more bees. And you can't just think of your bees as like, I have 5 hives, I have 10 hives. Like, it is an evolving organism that sometimes is big and sometimes is small, and you need to constantly be splitting that up and for the health of the bees right now. Any more questions? Yes?
What about those boxes that you use the turning of the screw to extract them?
Can you repeat the question? What are you talking about? He's asking about the flow hives. Does anybody know my opinion on flow hives? So the flow hives, let's give him a chance. He doesn't know. So again, like, I have my opinions. And, you know, they're not always right, but I believe in them. So I will tell you why I don't like the flow hive. So basically, the flow hive came out of Australia, and the idea, who's seen the video for the flow hives? Like, everybody, I can't tell you how many people emailed that to me, like, guess what? I hate you.
It's like me out of work.
As if you're the first person to send it to me. So the flow hive is a really well-produced video, like, pulls on your heartstrings, and the idea is that you basically have a Langstroth kind of style hive, and you have a crank on the side where you put this metal key, and you crank it, and then there's a tap out the back where the kids are out there with pancakes in the video, just like, oh mom, you're the best! And so, there's many reasons that I don't like the flow hive. You don't have to believe what I believe. So, not only do the bees make this beeswax themselves, essentially out of honey, and not only do they store their brood in it, and they store their food in it, and they live on it, it's also a conduit for communication. Mm-hmm. So bees can, they can figure stuff out. They got a brain. They can also feed themselves, but they like to co-feed. And one of the reasons they like to co-feed is, like I tell my kids in the class, just like when you're at lunch and your friend's like, guess what? And everybody's like, what? And they gather around. That's how bees do it. They like to, like, talk together. So they feed each other and simultaneously, like, rub antennas to get information. And they're also dropping that information on the hive. So a bee doesn't have to, like, report to somebody to know what the business is in the hive, because they're getting it. They know what's going on outside, they know what's going on inside, what are their responsibilities, what do they need more of, less of, what's going on. It's like the news bulletin. So when you take bees off of their natural beeswax hive and put them on any sort of rubber, I don't care how rubber friendly it is, whatever they sell it as, friendly rubber, it's still rubber.
So that's what it is they're creating.
And so they're creating a comb, because a honeycomb has cells on both sides, right? So you crank the key, and the comb splits in half, and the honey runs down and out a tube. I like stuff on tap. I like beer on tap. I would even be down with barbecue sauce on tap. I feel like, you know, things on tap are generally good. But for the health of the bees, it's not good. But in the video, it sells it as like, easy on the farmer, healthy on the bees, because you don't need to get in there and disrupt them. But again, like I said, there's information that you get through sight and smell and just intuition. I don't know any beekeeper that hasn't gone into a hive, doesn't quite, they couldn't articulate it to you, but they have this feeling. They're getting this message, they feel this vibe, they're one with their bees. If you want to be, you can totally get it on that level. And if you don't open the hive, if you just go to a hive and crank it and expect honey to come out, and this is my opinion, you know, take it with a grain of salt, to me, you're disrespecting the bees. Each bee makes less than 1/12 of a drop of honey in their whole life. So all those filthy hand kids at the market, like you have no idea what you just consumed. Get out. So, you know, you don't know if that honey is properly dehydrated. Like I said, you know, when they bring that nectar in, it takes a while to dehydrate it down to make it honey. You don't know if that's capped. You don't even know if there's young bees in that comb. You're just gonna like, give it to me, because I got my pancakes here. Some people think it's the cat's meow. Also, you don't have to have an extractor. So they're like, yay, this is really akamai.
Yeah, right.
You know, but like, discover yourself why it sucks. Also, our honey, especially in Hawaii, crystallizes. You know, everybody that's tried Kiavi is like, oh my God, what is this magic? It crystallizes really fast. And crystals grow crystals. And if our honey crystallizes in the comb, if you split it and drain the liquid and there's some crystals in there, you're gonna put it back together and it's gonna crystallize. You know, how many times are you gonna be able to use it before you have this mechanism that either won't open or won't shut? And then you're like, but that's not how it worked in the video. I personally think that the health of bees, and we'll start wrapping it up, the health of bees is in small-time beekeepers that really have the time to look at their hives, that really are emotionally invested. They're not just raping their wares and getting newbies. And that these hives in particular, in my humble opinion, move bees closer to factory farming and further away from the nurturing, loving, emotional connection that I'm going for.
Thank you so much for that.
Yes.
So I have a question.
Yes.
How much hives do you think a small time beekeeping?
Like I said, you missed that part. I didn't think I would have any more than 3. Now I have about 50. I'm really comfortable with about 25, 30 myself without feeling like I'm out of control. You know, there's, with any small time business, you have to decide, if you get bigger, you have to have employees, and then you're gonna have to talk to them and stuff.
Tell them what to do.
Irritable. And so I feel like I want to stay at a certain level, because as much as I like people, I also don't. I am happy to answer anybody's questions. What you should never say to a beekeeper, and I hear this hundreds of times, you can put a couple hives on my property.
Oh my God, I
and
hate
I'm
that.
Like, oh, you are brilliant. You thought that up all on your own, did you? So bees are dying, or people would be like, bees are dying in California. I'm like, they're dying around the world, but thanks for the heads up. I really am not nice sometimes. I apologize for that. So, you know, if you decide that it's too much for your farm, and this is really what I'm getting at, we haven't had pollination services in Hawaii because we haven't needed them. And now we have farmers that have a drop in yield. They've lost their income. The last thing they want to do is splash out more money on some unknown crackpot, because generally beekeepers are nuts. Not me. Everyone's like, no, we're totally loco. And so, you know, it's a lot of time and it's a lot of investment. If you want to focus on your farm, hire a beekeeper. Right now, beekeeping services in Hawaii are like 28 bucks per hive compared to 200 and something bucks on the mainland. Like, we are struggling. So, you know, you need pollination, we need flowers, let's work something out. Support a beekeeper. And, you know, then more people are more likely to beekeep and more people are gonna have sustainable beekeeping. And small-time beekeepers can get a little bit bigger because they have money to count on in the future. Yes, Jerry?
I remember you said you hive removal.
I do hive removal, so I kind of have scaled back on that, mostly because I was getting bees that were not healthy, so I would break saw up to get bees, and then I would get there and they'd be sick, and then I'm exposing my healthy bees. I don't know what these bees have. So for a couple years, I scaled back, and also I had enough bees. If you know somebody and they have bees and they need to get them removed, call a beekeeper. I personally wish that there was legislation fining people for killing bees. Yes, a can of Raid can kill the bees, but if you like to eat, don't kill the bees. It's like, it's that simple.
What I meant to say was, when you said that, it reminded me, a friend gifted me this hot bar that was created by some enthusiast carpenter, not beekeeper, and the thing is falling apart, and he gave it to me basically because it's a problem. And he said, here, use this for pollination and making swarms and stuff. I said, okay, well, I got a box out, I got some hives. I kind of want to get it out of there, but anytime I've done sort of removals where you move comb with brood and everything, I just kind of rubber banded it in there. Do you have a better technique?
If it's got honey in the comb, don't try. You know, give them just enough comb.
The brood, you mean?
Yeah, just give them just enough comb with brood in it so they feel like they recognize this environment. But don't you ever try, like, if it's got honey in it.
It's mostly just that it's all, it hasn't been tended and kept, so it's just waxed in everywhere.
Right.
And I want to put it in a Langstroth because I feel like that's more of a world language. You know what I mean?
So even if you have comb, you know, we talked about not using comb that you've gotten. Even if you use your own comb, you should also transition that out. That's a side point, not answering your question. So you're talking that it's a top bar hive.
It's a top bar.
It's really, really, really difficult to rubber band in a top bar hive. You know, if you rubber band in here, especially if you have, so he's saying he's got a hive, he wants to move them out. Just try to put them in a Langstroth hive because it gives you more structure.
Yeah.
And wire it because that gives you more structure. At Office Max, you get the big ass rubber band. I love them. And that, you know, don't try to like use little dinky rubber bands. But it's going to be easier to put it in a square hive, and then you could transition back into a top bar hive. I'll tell you about that. Yes. Yes.
I apologize if you covered this already.
No,
but recently we went to this class about killing fire ants, and they promote tango as safe for the bees.
They promoted what as safe for
tango.
Bees?
Tango.
Tango.
Which is the gel baby that everybody raves about, that you can treat big ants. And then some other, you know, organic farmer friends are telling me it's really hurting the bees.
I honestly don't have much information on small on fire ants because we've been relatively safe up here, and so I've just pled ignorance. I also no longer keep my bees in Puna, even though I love the bloom down there. It was taking $70 from my truck to get down there every week. And so I only keep my hives in a location that I can check on them every 2 weeks, otherwise it's not a healthy situation for them. So I personally don't have any information on the fire ants. I'm always leery to say if it kills one thing, it's gonna kill other things. Yes?
Yeah, we're just wondering, not so much the fire ants, it's just that people use the tango on fire ants.
So, yeah,
and
I
does
don't
the tango know. Affect bees?
I don't know that information yet, but I will investigate that.
Yes.
It has
like
insect growth.
I'm sorry, I don't know if you guys are... Huh? I have a question.
I will answer questions till the wee hours of the night, so don't feel bad.
What do you do with the queen if you can't kill her? Do you tell someone else to kill her?
It's like a situation. No, I have not had... I haven't brought in a hitman. So usually what I'll do is I'll split that hive. And I'll like put her with the weaker hive, and then when that hive dies, then I'll just be like, oh, that's the luck of the draw. But that's not good for the overall health of the hive. I understand that, but I'm not there yet.
I have another question. Yes. So when you're splitting, I had this question. I understand why you split because you're breaking the brood cycle, but I noticed that sometimes. Well, I just have a question because I know that right before these swarm, they clean the whole place really well. And so if you're splitting them, do they really get a chance to clean everything before that new queen emerges and a new life cycle starts in that current hive?
I didn't notice.
It also depends on the ages of the bees. So in a bee's life, at every age, they have a different job to do. And if you have bees that are really old, you're not gonna get the cleaning that you're gonna get if you have bees that are between like 8 to 15 days old because they're already moved on to another job. So that is a good thing to think about when splitting. It's something to take into consideration. You definitely have to make sure that when you split, each hive is going to have larvae, each hive is going to have honey, each hive is gonna have pollen. Even though I take honey out of the hive and take pollen out of the hive, I never ever take more than they have to eat. So that's another thing. When you live here, it's kind of like when you drive through the desert, and you're like, where's the next gas station? Can I pass this gas station or do I need to go to this gas station? So when I take honey out, I'm thinking, what's the next bloom? What's the next bloom cycle? This time of the year, there's so many blooms that I am virtually taking 100% out of the honey. Because in another 8 to 10 days, I'm gonna have to take more honey. But when you're at times when there's less blooms, you have to know when the next bloom is gonna come and kind of gauge it. How much can you take out of the hive? How much do you need to leave? People ask me, do I feed the hives? Never in Hawaii is there a need to feed your bees sugar water. Yes.
I was wondering, do you use the foundation sheets in your hives that are like plastic?
I have not used foundations for a while.
The plastic will fit.
I haven't used the plastic or the beeswax.
Do you use your extractor?
I do use my extractor. I have a hand crank and then I also have like a 6 or 8 crank electric one. I used to like love hand cranking. I'm such a homesteader, and then I was like, oh, I want an electric one. Like, it can be extracting, then you can stand and do something else. You don't have to be there cranking. But I like both of them. Yes.
Do you put those frames back in after you
into the hive? I do. Even if they're collapsed, I don't clean up the wax on the outside. You know, it might have a little bit of collapse. I, you know, push it in to make it as straight as possible, and it could have wax all around, and that's like an indication to the bees of where to continue. Gives them a head start. Anyone else? Thank you. Like Shinobi said, I'm going to... So I love good questions. Hit me up. Sometimes at Parker I don't have the time to answer questions. And if anybody needs more resources, I'm happy. I brought in a ton of books. So let me tell you that like some of my favorite books. The first book that I got and my absolute favorite is The Hive and the Honeybee. Wow. It's like a $50 book. It goes through every aspect. I read it before I got bees and I was like, I don't know what you're talking about. And then I got bees and I read it and I was like, I don't know what you're talking about. And then I learned more and then I was like, oh, right, okay, I heard about that. I still reference this book. It goes through so many different topics of beekeeping. It is an investment. I love this book. The Natural Beekeeper, also another one of my favorites. I generally have a couple mead books. I also am a huge fan of the Shamanic Way of the Bee. If anybody like really wants to like get intimate with their bees, a great book. You will be dreaming about bees. I generally don't loan these out, but feel free to touch them.
Thank you again for all of you guys for coming, and thank you for the Hamakua Cultural Center. out. There's also a sign in the sheets that you can hear about news and things that are happening here in the center. There's some fun new classes happening in June, so check it out. There's some posters in the front. And there's some to-go bowls over there. Take some soup home, otherwise my refrigerator is going to be full. And if you're not a member of the Farmers Union yet, I think you'll be able to, I'm not sure if you are from the
show.
You are? Okay, awesome. Yeah, then join us. There's like great benefits and we have meetings every month.
If you haven't gotten your card, have a card, your gift cards, for those members who haven't.
Yeah.
We also have hats, $15, and bumper stickers, 50 cents.
50 cents for a bumper sticker that says Food Sovereignty Now.
Can't get any better than that.
So yeah, thank you again so much for coming, and next month should be a good meeting too. I think we're going to have
a
candidate
follow-up.
Yeah, should be good. Yeah.